So let me introduce, thank you for coming to our talk today that is entitled Who Was My Grandmother? How Collective Memory Works in Folklore. And it's my pleasure to welcome for the third time at Hanfa our speaker, Dr. Elena Mignone. And let me just very briefly introduce the speaker. Елена Миньонок is a senior research scholar and the head of the Folklore Archive at the Institute of World Literature, Russian Academy of Sciences. She is author of books and book chapters, multiple articles on Russian folklore and on calendar rituals. She presented papers on folklore and ethnography at many, many conferences in Russia, Latvia, and the United States. Also, which it might be interesting to many of you, is that Elena is director of the board of the American Friends of Russian Folklore and leader of countless folkloric expeditions to the remote places in Russia, right? And not only in Russia.
Not only in Russia.
So many Americans went as volunteers. We have
Chris here.
Yeah, can ask Chris, about the first-hand
experience, sort of. Crystal was twice with me in Kamchatka and Don Kozak area.
Yeah, and
I highly recommend it.
Well, we will talk about it, I think. And also, she is a recipient of many grants and awards, including awards from Russian Academy of Sciences, Earthwatch Institute, Russian Humanities Scientific Foundation, and Fulbright. And she lectured at many leading universities in the United States, including Harvard, Pomona College, Boulder, Colorado, and others. So without further ado, give you Lena.
Thank you very much. I hope I will not disappoint you, and thank you very much for the invitation, because I really love to meet with American students, my American colleagues, and to share the results we have in our folklore expeditions. And I'm very thankful to the USA and America, because we started doing projects with American volunteers since 1995. So can you imagine that it was more than 20 years ago when the first time I came here to the USA, and we started cooperating with the Earthwatch Institute, and that's how we met first American volunteers who helped us to collect wonderful database, which is now a very big part of archive at the Institute of World Literature. So I'm very, all things which I will share with you today, it was collected with the help of American students and American colleagues and Russian colleagues and Russian students. So it's a big project of cooperation. And as Julia said, that in 2007 we set our non-profit organization, which is called American Friends of Russian Folklore. And if you're interested, you can visit the website. And if you're more interested, you're very welcome to participate in our folklore expeditions. And you don't need to speak Russian to participate in this expedition. So we are very happy to work with English-speaking students and professors. So, today my talk is about Russian migrants to Siberia. And when I was thinking about the title, I decided to give the name of the talk, Who is My Grandmother? And when we say the word, we pronounce the word granddaughter, well, of course we imagine people of what age? Maybe 15, maybe 20, maybe 25. So I will show you our granddaughters whom we interviewed, and the information we got from them was the basic for our research. This is granddaughters, and that's how they look like. So we interviewed more than 200 granddaughters for this project, and later I will tell you a little bit more about the project. So that who is my grandmother, that's the question of these granddaughters. Okay? Okay, here.
We don't need completely.
Another granddaughter. So to make things very clear, what
what time we will talk about. So here's another granddaughter, and wonderful ladies, and okay, granddaughter, another granddaughter, another granddaughter. Oops. Yeah, another granddaughter. So they address this question to their grandmothers. Who are you? And it was very important question of their childhood. So we will talk about Siberian villages, which were settled by migrants from Russian Empire during the Stolypin Reform. And we had a very interesting episode in Russian history, which is called Stolypin Agrarian Reform. You know that even, you know, the size of Russia, but there is a big paradox. Even having this huge size of Russia, peasants always had a lack of land. And Stalin, who was a very wise vice president, he started and he prepared a big reform for agriculture, offering peasants to take as much land as they want. And from Ural Mountains to the Far East. So the first migrants who went to Siberia, it was 1906 till almost 1916, when the First World War started. So that 8 years really changed lives of thousands and thousands of people. And generally speaking, more than 1 million people, only from western part of Russia, migrate to Siberia. And Siberia is very different in many ways. You know, usually the stereotype is Siberia is a land where people were exiled, it's a place of punishment and political punishment. But at the same time, Siberia is a motherland of many people who moved to Siberia, or their parents or grandparents moved because of the wonderful rich soil and black soil there. So today we will talk about families who migrated to Siberia. And in this sense, we can call Siberia our America. Why? Because people who moved there, they were motivated. Again, I repeat, we're not talking about people who were exiled, but we're talking about people who decided by their will to go to Siberia. And they were motivated by the very serious reason. They wanted to have better economical life. And they believed if they would go there and if they would have a big piece of land where they would work for themselves, they would really have decent economical life. So that was the first reason. And the second reason, that people really wanted to get freedom and to be free and to improve their social life. So these two basic reasons made millions of people to move to Siberia during these years. And Stolypin reform was a very important step because before 1906, we already had thousands of families who moved to Siberia. But it was very chaotic, it was not organized, people went there and they took any place they wanted. So Stolypin reform tried to organize this process. So people had money. The tickets were bought by their government, so they had tickets, they had money to start their agricultural business, they had seeds, and they had supplies from the government to start their new life, which should be much better than their life in Europe. And we visited during 4 years, so this project existed during 4 years, so we visited 12 villages in Siberia, and we visited near Irkutsk, because Siberia is huge, so these villages were settled near Irkutsk, and we visited 14 villages, their motherland villages. And it was very interesting to compare what kind of tradition we have in Siberia, in Siberian village, and what kind of tradition we have in their motherland village. And you can imagine, it can be compared with a social experiment. You have twins, you put one baby in one family and you put another baby in another family, and you see what, how different are these people who are twins originally, but they grew up in different families. So the same with traditions. You have one root, one tradition, and one tradition developed in the European part of Russia, and another tradition, the daughter tradition, developed in Siberia. And it's a very interesting period of time, which was very well investigated by economists, and we have very serious research books about the economical status of Stolypin reform, and social also status. But unfortunately, there is almost nothing written about culture. What happened with culture? And imagine people who moved to Siberia. They moved there, usually with their families and with their little children. And the age of people who went there was between 25 and 30, maybe 20 and 30. So sometimes they took their old parents. Sometimes they came without children. Sometimes they had, these families had one child. So they were young, very risky, very adventurous people who decided to change their life. And that's why I say that we can compare this with America. And what did they bring with them? Of course they brought icons, they brought their agricultural tools, but I was always interested in what they brought from a culture experience. Because we know that people left their European houses forever. And culture, it's also luggage. And if we go somewhere and we know that we leave our home forever, we cannot take all furniture with us. We cannot take all things which belong to us. We are very selective, so we take the most important things with us. So the same with culture. People moved there, and people who came to Siberia, they came from extremely rich, from land which is very rich with traditions. Because the biggest problem with land was on the age of Russian Empire, and which was the west of Russia. I mean, it, Poland, which was part of Russian Empire, and south. So that the places where people really suffered from because of the land, lack of the land. So what did they take? All of them knew a lot of songs, and repertoire of every village was near maybe 150 songs at minimum, at least 150 songs, can be 200 songs. They knew tons of fairy tales, they knew tons of rituals. So what do we have in the Siberian villages after 100 years? So I think it was a very interesting task to find out what these people have preserved and what these granddaughters have preserved. Because people whom we interviewed and who still are keeping their traditions, that people who were born between maybe 1930 till 1949, these 20 years. Because people who were born later, usually they lost their dialect, they lost their folklore language, they lost the language of metaphors. And it's very interesting because when we did records of folk music and children of these granddaughters who participated, and they asked me, do you understand every word? And of course they sang local language. I said, yes, I understand. Their children already do not understand their songs. They speak the same language, but during singing, there is a lot of transformation of vowels. So their children and grandchildren do not understand the language of the songs, and they do not understand metaphors. They do not understand poetic language of their songs. So this is the last generation of people who preserved some part of their motherland traditions. And we can see that their transformation, dynamics of traditions exists like in several chapters. So when we asked about identification of people, so how do you identify yourselves? Are you Russian? Are you Siberians? Are you Ukrainians? Are you Belarusians? It was the most complicated question.
And people really, they couldn't understand this in one word. So they need to describe their identification. And in all stories recorded when about childhood, when people started analyzing their identification, they said, well, I understood that my grandmother is not Russian, is not Siberian, when I saw huge empty things in our houses. What do people call as empty family things? It's huge boxes, and people brought them from European part of Russia, or it can be, you can see the size, or it can be baskets. And you can see family things. Usually they're hidden. It's quite rare when you can see this huge box in a house. It's somewhere in the barn, in the attic, in some secret places. So children, when they try to understand the world around them, when they investigated their yard, their house, they found these things. And they asked, Granny, how did you get it? And that was the first question where they heard the stories that we lived somewhere. And people use a local word, Россия, so they didn't say we lived in Ukrainian or we lived in Poland. They called it, we lived in Russia. So there was somewhere Russia. And this Russia, usually people imagined as an ideal, wonderful place. And the question is, if it was so good and it was so ideal, why did people leave this place? Why they decided to live in Siberia? And most of their granddaughters, they have never visited their motherland of their ancestors. But they heard stories. And the stories are about wonderful apple trees, cherry orchards, pear trees, and fruit which do not grow in Siberia. And some people, when they grew up, having these memories, they decided to go back to the motherland. But again, it's usually an exception. First of all, it's expensive, but it's not only about money, it's about coming back to the stage which you already left. So people were not very initiative about coming back, but some did. And when they came back from this motherland villages, they were very disappointed. And they all say, it's interesting that 100% of people whom we interviewed, they said, how wonderful that our grandparents came here to Siberia. I said, why? You told me about cherry orchards, you told me about apple trees. But I said, yes, but you know how huge is Siberia. I go out and I can see the whole valley. I can cut hay for my cow close to my house. But in their motherland village, they build houses wall by wall. So they have no fields, they have no forest to cut firewoods. So it's again the same question of place and land. So even after 100 years, people still feel huge difference between space in Siberia and space in these motherland villages. So that's the very beginning. So they start with family, big family things. Then they try to analyze houses. And people said, yes, when I was a little child, I always thought, why do you have so long houses? Because most of houses in the neighbor villages can have square forms or not so long. So this is a very typical house for migrants from Polish Belarusia, from western part of Belarusia. And it could have even 5 windows or 6 windows. So people understood that there is something very different about their houses. And I put this picture also to show you a couple of stones near the houses. Can you see them? Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting story about the stones, that people who migrated, grandparents, they brought stones from their motherland village. And I thought there are some romantic feelings, they want to remember their motherland. So no, we brought the stones to push cabbage when we made it
sour. So you need some press, some kind of press. So people who moved to Siberia, they thought there were no stones in Siberia. And they brought these huge stones with them to use it for their cabbage when they made it sour. And again, when we analyze every house of migrants, you may ask questions about each corner. It's so interesting because every frame of a window, of a corner, of logs, of stones, can have real stories behind it. Next, after houses, children, our grandmothers, they also paid attention to inside the house in more details. Here you will see how the houses look inside. They're very clean, and you can see logs, and the middle of the house is a table. And here, granddaughter inside the house. And it's interesting that in the corner, you will not see an icon. And it's really amazing, because when you go in folklore expeditions in European part of Russia, in every house you visit, you will see icons in the holy corner. But here, it can be some kind of embroidery, it can be portraits of family members, it can be portraits of even some political figures, but no icons. And it's a really amazing thing, and when we started asking questions, we found out that religion was not the thing people took with them. Of course, the first generation of people who moved to Siberia, they were religious, but because they moved in the 1906 till 1916, and then we all know the October Revolution happened, and in the 20s, local churches were ruined. There was no attempt to rebuild a church. And I met people who are 85 or more years old who were not baptized, which is very, very rare case in European part of Russia. But we'll talk about icons a little bit more here. And we can see that every corner is decorated. And one of the biggest part of decoration is local pillows. Pillows in every house is very decorated. And when we ask who made this decoration, who made this embroidery, that's already granddaughters who did this. So the tradition existed in this villages through embroideries, and this is very obvious. Like, you can visit 10 houses and maybe people will have carpets, or they will have no carpets, or they will have wallpaper, or maybe they will not have wallpaper, but each house will have a very huge pillows with beautiful embroidered pillowcases. And you can see that the coverage of the bed is modern, so it's not the old type of coverage. But on the top, even in the modern looking house, you still will see these pillowcases which were embroidered by these grandchildren of people who migrated to Siberia. It's interesting to compare this with the Polesia villages, because nowadays in the literature, these villages are called Belarusian, but I try to avoid this term because they were not Belarusians. They were Polishuki, they were people from Polesia, and they lived between the border, Ukrainian border, and Polish border. And they are Polesia, Polishuki, and these villages still exist. And when you come inside the house, the first thing you see is a huge pillows covered with pillowcases. Okay. So you can see this is traditionally organized bed, and the bed can be modern bed, but they still have the same thing. So this is very, another thing which is close, and it's very obvious to us that tradition should exist and should continue in clothes. I will show you first the costume of Polesia, Polishuki people. People still wear, people do not go like this in everyday life, but they still wear it for holidays. So,
is 47 years old, and for wedding, for big festivals, she wear this costume. And pay attention to the skirt. For this motherland village, this scarlet skirt was very typical. They called them andarak, but this term exists from the border of Poland to the middle of European part of Russia. So it's a very widely spread term. And sometimes they call andarak the whole dress, but here in this motherland village, they call andarak only this skirt. And you can see the way how women organize their hair. And if we logically think about this, that's how grandmothers or these granddaughters looked like 100 years ago. And it's interesting that first when we went to Siberian villages, to the migrants, they described us, the costume of their grandmothers. Oh, it's a long red skirt, it's an apron, it's a vest, and then they had something very complicated on their hair. And first we had description, like verbal description of the costume. And then we went to the motherland village, and we saw this costume in a real form. And it's a very interesting like time phenomenon. Like it's the same year, the same month, but metaphorically, you're like 100 years ago. So we took pictures of these ladies from the motherland village and sent these pictures to the Siberian village. And that's exactly how your grandmother looked like. But you are 80 and this woman is 47 years old. But you can imagine what kind of clothes these people brought when they moved to Siberia. But we decided to go a bit forward and we said, okay, how looked like grandmothers of these women if they have this costume, and this is still an alive element of folklore culture, people still use it, maybe they can describe us how their grandparents looked like. And it was very interesting because they described us the costume, and when they found this costume in their museums, and I will show you another. You can see it's the same skirt, but it's absolutely different headdress, which is called danitka. So that's how grandparents of these women look like. So it's a very interesting phenomenon. In 1 year, in 1 month, you can see elements of culture which existed 100 years ago and even 150 years ago. And also, I want to pay attention to the white color in the costume. And even they do not call themselves Belorussians, which is literally means white Russians, but they have a lot of white color in their costumes. This is the back. And it's interesting that this costume didn't come to Siberia. It was already too archaic, too old. So people who moved to Siberia who was 20, 25 years old, they thought this is too old fashioned. So they were dressed differently. And nowadays, granddaughters, they remember the costume of 1906, 1910, but not the traditional old Polesia costume. Male variant. And this is such a bright thing as a red skirt. It should happen something with this in the culture, because with white shirt, you may use it for maybe some pieces of fabric, but with this very bright color, obviously should happen something in culture. So we started asking questions, what happened with the skirts, which your grandparents brought to Siberia, and we got very interesting answers. We used them for pillowcases. So women, granddaughters, they took skirts of their grandmothers and made pillowcases and used for their pillows. So again, we can see
how the dynamic of tradition, and it, you do not expect this answer. So we asked, where are the skirts? And women pointed out on their pillows that, oh, here are the skirts. But I was very intrigued, and I really wanted to see the real skirt, because I wanted to be sure that my hypothesis is right. And their grandparents came exactly in the clothes people described me. And I was keeping asking in every yard, maybe, do you have a skirt? Do you have a skirt? And I was lucky. In one family, they still had it. And when an old woman, a granddaughter, took it out from her box and I asked her to put it on her, she said, no, 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 no. Only my granddaughter can do it, because I'm too old to have this scarlet skirt. So she called her granddaughter, and that's a granddaughter of a granddaughter who put on this skirt, and she allowed us to take a picture of it. Okay, so then next, what happened with religion? And as I told you that, to my great surprise, religion was not the thing which people brought, they brought it with them, but it's not the thing which stayed with these migrants. And because it was serious repressions against religion, and people were not allowed to build a new church, and they were not allowed to practice it, they didn't make any attempts even to go to Irkutsk, which is maybe 100 miles or less from this place, and to be baptized. And it was a very interesting. So I asked these ladies, you know, you came from, your grandparents came from a very religious area where people are very serious believers. How that could happen that you're not baptized? You are 80, 85 years old. And people look very easily at this. It's like, okay, no problem. You know, we had no church. It was forbidden, so we didn't do any attempts. And my children grew up, they were not baptized. And when my daughter is 50 years old, she decided to go to the woods and baptize. So it was a very easy answer. And nobody was really puzzled by this question. So it was a thing which people easily left behind. They didn't take it with them. And I would like to show you the big difference. So here is the icon. Here's an icon in their motherland village. And you can see that this is a spiritual center of every house in motherland village. It is very well decorated. It usually has several icons, and people put clean ritual scarves around icons before every big religious holiday. So you can see that people take very good care of this icon, for example, another. And it is not, again, these pictures are not selected, so you can visit every house in the motherland village, and you can see that this decorated holy corner in every house. And it doesn't matter who lived there. It can be a man, a woman, a young person, a young couple, but every family has this holy corner. And then we visited Siberian village, and among 200 houses, I found only one house with an icon of St. Nicholas, decorated with their ritual scarf, but it's not handmade. It was bought, and St. Nicholas is the most respected saint, but among 200 houses, it was the only one icon. Okay. Now, what happened with folklore? And as I said, people who moved, who decided to leave their motherland village, they were very religious, and then their children were less religious, and their grandchildren are not religious at all. I wouldn't say that they are atheists. They would never say this, but they do not practice any religion. they do not visit churches. Maybe on Easter they dye eggs, that's the only thing they do. But they strongly believe in witches. And witches and witchcraft, and believes in house spirits and forest spirits, is a very basic forms of their religion. And first time when I, and as I said, the other things were the first I went to Siberian villages, and then I went to their motherland in Polesia. So my first introduction to this dynamics of folklore traditions was from Siberia. And when we came there, the local teenagers told us, you know, tomorrow is a very, very important day, it's Van Gopala, and we need to chase out a witch. And I said, okay, may I join you? He said, no, you're old, stare, you cannot, it's only for teenagers. I was very lucky, I took my children, and I said, okay, your task is to follow, to be among the group of teenagers, and to tell me what they're doing, and to document if you can. So what is it to chase out a witch? This village has 200 houses, as I said, so it's near maybe 50, 40 teenagers in the whole village. So they gather together in the late evening, and to the sunrise, they are running down the streets, and they make ritual chaos. They make ritual disorder of things. And we know it from anthropological studies that it's quite a common thing that before Christmas or before Easter or before another holy day, people, young people, teenagers, they can ruin fireworks, they can ruin gates, they can ruin fences, they do this. So in my mind, I thought, well, it's a traditional forum. So you know, they did it all the time. So nothing special about this. And I will show you, and because it was teenagers do it at night, it was absolutely no possibility to take pictures. So I sent my children, that is to chase out a witch, to put some walls or to make some disorder on the road. And it can be very different forms, like this, sometimes it's only one log, or in front of the gate, about the long houses, you can see that the typical house in this area has a square form, and it's a very serious influence of Buryat houses, because typical Buryat house has a square form. And this is a local store, so in front of a store you can see a little element of disorder. This log in the middle of the village, so it's big fun. Mm-hmm. Okay, so teenagers do this, they gather in groups. It can be 5-6 groups in one village, and every group tries to bring the sticks and to cross the road, and that means to chase out a witch. And as my children said, that it was a very interesting atmosphere. Imagine it's a special holy night, which is July the 7th, which is a mirror reflection of Christmas, because Russian Orthodox Christmas is January the 7th. So exactly another half of the year, July the 7th, is Ivan Kopala. And it's a special night. And everybody knows it's a special night. because there are many witches, and witches are everywhere. So you need to cross the roads and expectations that you can meet a witch. And you can meet maybe a cat, but a cat, obviously it's a witch, because this is a special night when all witches go out. So it's a very exciting night. And if you know Russian social nets, we have social net ВКонтакте.
Facebook, right?
This is Facebook. It's a special social net,
most network.
Network, yeah. ВКонтакте. When teenagers, they gather together, and even some of them who left the village and they study in Irkutsk, they come back in their village, especially for this night, and they gather together. So it's a very important social activity to chase out the witch. And as my children said, it was very scary, it was very exciting, and it was also very scary because people were not happy when somebody ruined their fences. The question is, where did you get the sticks and how did you do this? And here's another pictures, which is also, you can see some ruined fences here. You can see empty holes. So sticks were taken to chase out the witch. And okay, it's a ruined fence. And also a ruined pile of firewoods. And already 4 o'clock in the morning, there was a man who tried to fix his fence. Because, of course, everybody knows that. And it's interesting that the reaction of adult people, when you ask them, well, what do you think about this practice? Is it good or bad? Everybody's laughing. I said, oh, you know, when we were children, we did the same. And of course, adults were angry. They tried to catch us. They tried to punish us. But we need to run away. So teenagers are not afraid not only of witches, but they're afraid of real people who maybe guard their fences during this night, and they really don't want their fences being ruined, even if they approve this tradition. So from the first glance, it seems it's a normal practice, it's very typical for Slavic villages to do this. But to my great surprise, when I came to the motherland village and I asked a question about this ritual disorder on the night of Lan Gopala, nobody knew about this. And I thought, well, maybe people forgot about this, maybe, you know, many things can happen during 100 years. So I kept asking and asking, and there was no single person who said, yes, we have such a tradition. And then I started reading literature about the area, and we had a very serious group investigating Polesia, which was, this research was made in the 90s under Academic Tolstoy, Nikita Ilyich Tolstoy. They mapped all rituals. And to my great surprise, when I opened the book of calendar rituals and I saw the map of Polesia, I saw the motherland villages with special sign which said they do not have ritual disorder. So people did not forget it. They really didn't have it. So the question is, I know exactly the date that the village was settled in 1910. I know people who were born in 1930s who said, we did this when we were children. And I know that in their motherland village, they didn't have this tradition. So it was a wonderful riddle for anthropologist or ethnographer, folklore researcher, because you have three facts you know. And we started to interview people asking this question. 100% of people said, you know, we exactly did this when we were children. Okay. So my oldest person whom I interviewed with this information, she was born in 1923. So she's almost more than 90 years old. She said, I remember this. When we were children, my older sisters, my older siblings did this. So that means that in the 20s, they already had this tradition. And they moved to this place in 1910. And they moved from a place where they had no tradition. So can you imagine that during these 13 years, because of the belief, during these 13 years, we can prove that a new tradition was born. again, traditions cannot be born by itself. It should be some background for this. What happened in their motherland villages? Okay, you do not have this tradition. You do not make any ritual disorder. But do you believe in witches? Oh, yes. What do you know about witches? I don't have a long questionnaire about witchcraft. What kind of practices do you have? And the most important thing was about Ivan Kupala. So what witches do on Ivan Kupala? And the only one thing that people mention, and again you need a lot of answers, is that, oh, you know, we know that, and our grandparents told us that the witches can visit your house in the night of Ivan Kupala. So we put nettle between windows. And you know, nettle is a symbol of fire. It has the same symbolism as fire to clean the place. So use a nettle, stinging nettle. It means also to clean the place. So our grandparents told us that we need to put nettle between windows so that witch will not come inside the house. But again, as I said, no ritual disorder, only this belief. So people who came in Siberian village in 1910, they brought this belief that night of Ivan Kupala, there's a special night when witches can enter your house. But because she's a witch and not a human being, she doesn't use a door. She uses a window or a chimney or some special entrance. So to protect your house, people use nettle, and they put nettle.
Nettles are the крапива?
Крапива. Вот. По-лески прокева. Крапива, they use крапива to protect their house. That's the only belief people brought when they came to Siberia. Then this generation had children. And of course, children heard about this belief. But they had no practice. And somewhere and somehow, between 1910 and 1923, the new tradition appeared. They decided to cross the road to chase out a witch. And the question, do people in this area have nettles? No, they have no nettles. And it's very logical, they had no nettles. So how can I protect my house? How I can protect my windows? People, teenagers, started to cross roads and make this ritual disorder. But if you, I would not visit the motherland village, I would never find this out. So it shows how folklore is a very alive form. And it's very alive, especially among teenagers. And moving to another place, taking only one belief, helps people to create the whole ritual, which nowadays is one of the most alive elements of local tradition. So, beliefs, it's interesting to see that religion was the thing which was left behind. Christian ideas were the things which people left behind, but witchcraft and protecting their house from witches, it was the thing which people developed. And even after four generations, they still practice it, and I'm pretty sure that they will practice it with next generation. It's interesting to see what happened 100 years later. So maybe if my grandchildren would be alive, they could go to this place and see. Because it's really interesting to see their alive element of tradition. What happened with other forms of folklore? The very important thing which started to disappear after the first generation was the language. As I said, people spoke Полесский dialect, which is, this is very well described by linguists. So it's a special dialect which has features of Ukrainian language, some features of Polish language, and a little bit of Belarusian, but mostly Ukrainian and Polish. And people still speak this dialect in the western part of Belarus, in Polesia. But obviously when they come to Siberia, they started losing this language. And already their grandchildren did not speak Polesian dialect. But they perfectly understood each other. So there was no language barrier between grandparents and grandchildren. But grandparents found that the language of grandchildren is very unbeautiful.
And again, we can hear this from grandmother. Grandchildren thought it was very unbeautiful to speak Polesian dialect. And in every family, we recorded some very funny stories about misunderstanding, using of the same words, but in Polesian context or in Russian context. But some words were really forgotten. And a very interesting story I recorded from one of granddaughter, who is 83 years old. She said, "Oh, I remember my granny, and now she was knitting a she was knitting stockings." And I said, "Oh, what are you doing?" And she said, "I'm making stockings for your older sister." And she said, "I also want stocking." And the Russian word for stocking is chulki. So, yeah, chulok. It's a Russian word. But granny said, "Okay, I will knit for you uchuhi."
Take another one.
Sorry. I will make for you uchuhi. "No, I don't want uchuhi. I want stockings. I want chulki." But it's the same thing. But granny wanted to tease her, so she said, "I will also knit uchuhi for you." And this is linguistic stories. It's very typical of family history. So when we ask questions about language of grandparents, they all tell us one or two jokes when grandparents used some old words. And also to give you the real picture here. So this is Irkutsk province, and you can see this is Lake Baikal, the blue lake, and here is a tiny village. Like here. And the distance between the motherland village and this village is the same distance as between London and New York. Exactly the same. Because I always wanted to show in a very obvious form how to compare this distance. So you know how many hours we need to take to come from London to New York. It's 5 hours. Can you guess how long did it take to come from motherland village to Siberian village? Wow, yeah. 6 months.
6 months.
6 months, and 6 months because they were stopped. They didn't go all the time. The Stalypin trains were very slow, and the people, because they came with their children, they need to do laundry, they need to have rest, so time to time they would spend 2 weeks on one station. And they gave the road to other trains. So they moved very, very slowly. So we can compare in 100 years, 6 months, and 5 hours. But the best story I heard about time and distance, that one couple, and because, as I said, people really wanted to go to Siberia, for them it was a chance to change their life. And they had tickets from the government. One couple was late for the train. And they were so upset that they took 2 oxen and they came to the village, to Siberian village, by oxen. And it took 2 years. And they came with 2 babies. So, and I know about the story because in archive of Stalypin Reform, it was very well documented because everybody had a special money, like money to support the family. And a man had 15 rubles, which was very big price. A woman had 5 rubles, a woman had 10 rubles, a boy had 5 rubles, and a girl had a ruble. So because they came with 2 babies, they were their money to support the family was recalculated. And it was very well described in a special document. So people came with already 2 babies. And what happened with other folklore? So people start losing language. And it's always the same process. When people lose the language, they lose folklore. Because if you have no language to tell fairy tales, you forget fairy tales. If you have no language to describe what's around you, you lose language, and you take other words, you take other constructions to describe the world which is around you. But songs are very conservative, and musical speech is much more conservative than oral speech. And it's really interesting that in oral speech, people do not use dialect, even grandma, daughters. They can use slightly оканье, полезское оканье, they can use slightly or in an unstressed position before the stressed syllable, but they do not speak the same way as people in the motherland, but they sing in the same way. And that's really amazing, because when we go to the motherland village and we told the stories, told about this place, people looked at us quite skeptical. And it's another interesting form of collective memory. When you have a social group or a community, and part of this community leave this community, let's say to America or to Siberia, it's interesting that people forget about them very quickly. It takes maybe two generations to forget about them. So when we go to the motherland villages and ask, do you remember that here it was one third of the village which left this place for Siberia? No, nobody went to Siberia from our village. We always lived here. So collective memory doesn't preserve information about people who left. But people who left the village, they perfectly remember the place about their motherland. So as I said, when we came to the motherland village and we told them the story that in the middle of Siberia, for modern Belarusians it sounds like in the middle of nowhere, there's a village which was settled by your ancestors, and there are 500 people. So no, 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 you're mistaken, it couldn't happen. But when then you showed them the music, and you showed them the song, they said, oh yes, exactly. They sing in our manner, they sing in our style, and it's absolutely told to the same group of people. And just to give you some feelings about sounds, I translated a couple of songs, and I really want to show you the songs. Another very interesting phenomenon that, as I said, people who came there, they brought maybe a repertoire of 200 songs. I mean, not romances, not modern songs, but classical folklore songs, ritual songs, and lyric songs. Imagine a repertoire of 200 songs. And now, in both places, in motherland village and in Siberian village, people remember not more than 10, 15 songs. So the number is the same. And usually it's very rare old ballads. Why? Because ballads tell you about some unhappy event. And generally, Slavic lyric songs, they do not have plots. It's a chain of associations. Oh, here is a girl, she's crying on the bank of the river. Oh, here is a guy, he's cutting hay in the meadow. Oh, here is a widow and she's happy because her husband died. So it's a, it's quite a common motif in Slavic songs. So, but it's a chain of associations. It has no plot. So these songs disappeared in both places. They disappeared in Siberian villages, they disappeared in motherland villages. But ballads, and ballads tell you about some big unhappy event. They exist in both places. And to show you the tune and to show you the lyrics, I wanted to give you one example. So here is, and I put in both in Russian and in English. So here is the tune.
Значит, Мария Евтихьевна, фамилия?
Хорошко.
Хорошко. Значит, запись сделана 15 августа 2015 года.
It's only English. It's
okay. Беларусь, Ивановский район, Брестская область, right. Село, деревня Ополь. От Марии Евтихиевны Горошко. Спасибо.
You can see, yeah?
Пора матери то
and as every song in this era, it's a long song because people tell you the story and they do not use the word to sing a song, they say to tell a song. Рассказать песню. And it's a long story how a young husband, he brought a young wife, and mother-in-law didn't like the young wife, so she decided to poison her. She put she put poison in her dish, but the son, young husband heard about this, so he also ate this dish together with his young wife, and they both died. And then mother buried them in separate graves, but there were two trees growing on their graves, and the tops of the trees were interwoven. It's interesting that this ballad exists in all Slavic peoples. You can take Bulgarian variants, you can see Serbian variants. It always means that this song existed before different Slavic groups became separate. Because when you have something the same among many ethnographical groups or many national groups, and it's something the same, it always tells you that this is the most archaic things. So interesting that more recent songs, which people sang, obviously at the beginning of the 20th century, they forgot it. But very archaic forms still exist, and they exist in both locations. And so to the very end, I would like again to underline that, you know, all materials we collected with our American volunteers, students, and professors, and you can't imagine how interesting is every discussion at the end of the evening, because when we see this phenomenon and we can talk about family history, and usually American team members, they start to think about their families, and they tell stories about their grandparents. And at the very end of here, so again, and all, some people ask me, how can you take, you know, volunteers who do not speak Russian? But first of all, we always have people who speak both languages, and they participate and doing videotaping, audio taping, and of course, eating and drinking, which is the most important thing what people do together. And at the end of every recording session, usually Russian or Belarusian or Palestinian or Siberian people, they say, and now you Americans, please sing your national songs, your folklore songs. And for most Americans, it's a very difficult question, and they say, we know how to sing, which is usually the answer with local people don't understand. It said, but you can talk. If you can talk, you can sing, because it's the same thing. And for most of people who grew up in villages who preserve folklore traditions, they do not understand singing as a special skill. For them, it's the same natural as to talk. So Americans have to sing their folklore song. I want to give you some No, I'm not laughing, I just think it's.
Christmas is your land, Christmas is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me.
From their grandparents, from their great-grandparents, because when people pass away, we have more questions than answers. And I think it's very, very important to talk with grandparents and ask, you know, who are you? And how was your childhood? What games did you play? And from what place did you come? So thank you very much. And if you have questions, you're very welcome.
Questions,
May I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
Those costumes which the women were wearing for special occasions, mm-hmm. are they still being produced or do they combine something they buy in?
They don't buy, yeah, thank you. They don't buy, they usually preserve it as from their grandparents and they really value it. It's absolutely impossible to buy it. But some Americans were gifted. We have cases when a woman took, you know, a shirt, said it's a shirt of my grandfather, please take it and bring it to America. So and it's a very serious gift. But some elements can be worn out, so they can reproduce elements. Or they try, for example, crochet. The fabric can be already worn out. But it's linen, and linen is quite good. It's a good quality linen. But they can use crochet and make an apron from another fabric and use the same crochet. Yeah.
And embroidery is still being done?
They still do it. Embroidery in the Polesia, in Ukrainian villages and Belarusian villages, it's still an alive form of folk art. People do. And they use patterns of their great-grandparents. So they repeat the forms. Not 100%, but some basic motifs. Yes?
You said they do this in Belarus as well?
Belarus, but what we have now as Belarus, this country appeared only in 1991. So before part of this belonged to the USSR, another part belonged to Poland. Mm-hmm. And before 1917, it was Kingdom of Poland, Polskie Carstwo, but it was part of Russian Empire. So when I speak with Belarusians, they hate the word Polesia in Polishukie. So now we're all Belarusians. But Polesia people said, no, we're not Belarusians, we're Polish, we're Polishukie. So it's complicated. So to make things easier, sometimes I can use the term Belarusian, but that's not right. It's a Polesia, it's Polishuki.
Okay. So the last name Polishuk comes from there?
Exactly. The people from forest, Polesia.
Mm-hmm. It's a very typical last name, Polishuk. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Yes?
Thank you so much, it was very interesting. I have a question because it seems like it's a women's narration. Even your title refers to grandmothers. Mm-hmm. And who appeared in these pictures were mostly women, and women were singing. Where are men in this?
Yes, it's a good question. And the biggest problem was the Second World War. Because when we collect data in every village, in Siberia or modern Belarus or Ukraine, we have special tomb with a list of people who died. And statistic is that 20 men who went to the war, only one came back. So they did not exist. And tradition was interrupted. They had, of course, they had male tradition, they had male songs, but we have no opportunity to do any records. These people just, and another very interesting, if time allows,
yes.
I want to give you an absolutely wonderful example of cooperation and how we, very often we do not realize how we are all connected, like Siberia, Russia, Polesia, America. So this part of Polesia where this motherland, and motherland villages were not necessarily in Polesia, it can be in Belarus, in eastern part of Belarus, but I spoke about this exact example. They were part of Poland till 1949. And they didn't call themselves Poles, so they called themselves Belarus, Polesia, Polishuki, but they were citizens of Poland. So in the 30s, most of them went to America because they had people who did not move to Siberia, they still had problems with land, they had no land because all land belonged to Polish landlords. So they went to America, and almost in every family, we heard stories. My grandfather, he went to America, and he came back, and he brought so much money. I said, okay, in what year did he come to America? So it was 1930, 1931, 1932, maybe 1928, the time of Great Depression. And I said, wow, what did they do in America? It was such a big question to me, because I couldn't find in any literature. But it was a very stereotypical answer. Oh, you know, I have this beautiful house because my grandfather, he went to New York and he brought tons of money. And they all went to New York. So they didn't go to other places. So the answer, and I want to give you, and I even have a very interesting picture. Okay, here, see? And that's from a local museum, and they could, nowadays people could identify only two men. But this picture was made in New York. See how they fancy look like, no? And I tried to find some sources in literature what Polesian man could do in New York to make a lot of money in the time of Great Depression. And I couldn't get this answer. And I asked American historians, and nobody could answer me. And then finally, we wrote a letter to the Library of Congress. And I, in the many details, describe, you know, here is a big research, and it's a very important pattern of oral history that Belarusian man from the northern Belarusia was a Polesia. They went to America and they brought a lot of money. What could they do there? And after 1 year and a half, I got an answer from a very nice librarian, and librarians always are our best friends. And she gave me special information about two books where I got the answer. Can you guess what did they do in New York to make a lot of money
in Great Depression?
In the time of Great Depression. Any guess?
Construction?
Sorry?
Construction? Some kind of building? Like
close.
ACC or...
Close, but not construction. Construction. Close.
Carpentry?
No.
What?
Does that have something to do with agriculture?
No, it was with industry. Yeah.
Oh, in
but
New York.
They in New York.
I don't know.
I'm thinking something
different. But
bootlegging.
What's interesting, they did not build the houses, they ruined the houses. So
they
put dynamite and they exploded.
Yeah,
they blew up the houses. Because the government needs space for skyscrapers. And these places were not empty. They had buildings here. And nobody really wanted to do this hard work. And for some reason, these people from Polesia, who had experience in the First World War, they did this, and they were very well paid. So that the money they brought, and they bought a piece of land in Polesia. But unfortunately, in 1939, they became part of the Soviet Union, and it was the end. Okay, please.
So they were not part of the Soviet Union at the time, right?
They were not? No, no, no. If they would be part of Soviet Union, they would never be able to go to the USA.
Yeah.
No, it was before 1939. Even before maybe 1935, end of 20s and beginning of 30s. So we knew a little bit about men, but unfortunately we cannot interview them. And men who were born after the war, they were raised by women, and they do not know real male, local male tradition. They can tell you about weddings, about funeral, which was always a sphere of women. But they are not hunters, they are not fishermen, they don't know much about traditional male.
What do they do presently in those villages?
Where? In Siberia?
In Siberia.
In Siberia. Generally speaking, it's a very interesting observation that Siberian villages which were settled by Stalin reform and which was settled by migrants economically are much more advanced and developed than traditional old Siberian villages. I'm not talking about minorities, I'm talking about Slavic population of Siberia. And even when the Soviet Union collapsed, many of them decided to buy the land. And they made corps, and they survived. And one of my biggest surprise was when I came there in 1996, and when most of European villages were ruined, people had absolutely no money, nothing. In 1996 and 1998, almost there was a car near every yard in these Stalypin Siberian villages. And in 2000, there was the internet almost in every house, which was absolutely huge surprise to me. So people who came to this place, as I said, we can compare them with Europeans who left there who left Europe and they went to America. So they were risky, they were adventurous, they were looking for better economical life. And they believed with their hard work, they really think that their children and grandchildren, they value education, strongly value education. Their old grandchildren usually, and when we interview these granddaughters who are 80 and 83, they all are very proud of their grandchildren. So, you know, my grandson, he's a student of Irkutsk Medical School or of a School of Engineering, or he goes to China, or he goes to Japan. And of course, most of students, they go to China and Japan, to Asian countries, not to European countries. They do a lot. They have crops, they have private farming. I interviewed a family, they had 300 cows. Can you imagine? Two people, and they hired two more people who work for their farm. So they have 300 cows. So different things, but the level of life, economical level of life in Siberian villages, but specifically Stolypin Siberian villages, I'm not talking about, because there are different types of villages. There are old believers in Siberia, there are people who moved there from north 400 years ago, but Stolypin Siberian villages are much more economically improved than European villages. And in the motherland village, in what is now territory of Belarus, it's interesting to say that there is a very strong support to preserve culture in Belarus, much better than in Russia. They have encyclopedias, they have special collections, and they're all printed and made by Belarusian Academy of Sciences through the grants they got from the government. So it's a very serious interest in this. And in one little district can be 20 singing groups, and more or less authentic singing groups, but it's a very strong revival movement in Belarus, which I can't say about Russia, unfortunately.
More questions?
What happens to a cat which embodies a witch and met on the road? I think the cat would be done for, right?
Not necessarily. We have a very typical motive in witchcraft that women and men can take shapes of different animals. There is only one animal which witches and warlocks cannot take, it's a cow, because cow is holy. So no witch can turn into a cow. But it can be dogs, frogs, cats, different birds. People have a fear, they are afraid. They wouldn't kill a cat, they're afraid. But I did a lot of records, I recorded a lot of stories that some man, maybe my uncle, my neighbor, or somebody, he found a cat in the yard, and the cat was milking a cow, and so he hit a cat. And next day, his neighbor had a big bruise on her face, or she had a broken leg, or a broken hand. But it's folklore, it's not real life. And it's a very big difference, because folklore is not a reflection of real life, it has another mechanism. And I remember a wonderful situation when my narrator, she told a very picture story that a neighbor, she came in the Easter night, she came in the yard and, as a cat, and she milked a cow. And her daughter was listening and said, wait, how a cat can milk a cow? And she ruined the whole story immediately. My mother said, but you know, this is the story, listen. And then she took the milk and my cow had no milk. How could she carry two buckets of milk? So if you start thinking logically, it doesn't work. So people do not kill cats. They tell stories about wounded cat who turned into a wounded witch.
I just find it incredibly strange and fascinating that they so easily reverted to paganism.
Easily.
Just in 3 seconds, they're pagan all of a sudden.
Exactly. And all the stories, how religious was Russian and Slavic peoples, it made me very skeptical. Because it took only 20 years that people immediately forgot all these practices. And it's another topic, and I also can talk about this, and it's really interesting. When you talk with old people who are these granddaughters who are 80, 85, who have never been to church, no single time in their life, they're not baptized. And of course, you ask them questions, and would you like to go to church? And I remember that several women told me, you know, I'm so sinful. If I would go to a church, the church bell will fall down and then people will be killed. So maybe it's better for me not to go to the church. But people speak about this with absolute peace in their soul. There is no drama. There's no tragedy about this. And there's a huge contrast between people of the same age in their motherland village and people who just were left without churches and no tragedy. They perfectly survived. But yeah, witches and witchcraft. And again, I also want to underline that witches are not necessarily negative, because in Slavic folklore, a witch, etymologically, the word means she knows more than others. Vedas, she knows more than others. So it's not necessarily that she's bad. She can be very good. It's magic, and magic is magic. You can use it for good purposes, you can use it for bad purposes. It's up to you.
Last year, Yelena presented us a talk, A Witch Next Door, so about the comparative analysis of witches and different...
It's very
so
alive
do
tradition.
They have witches?
Oh yes, it's a very alive tradition. And the main observation is when people move to another place, the witchcraft tradition is much stronger because they need to make cultural the unknown place. They meet new forests, they meet new roads, they build new houses. So this place which belonged to nature before, now they came, it should belong to their culture. And if in the motherland village they can have two healers, but in the new village they will have 10 healers. And healers is always, very often is their synonym to a midwife and to a witch. It can be the same person. A healer, a midwife, and a witch, the same person. And I remember one wonderful healer, she told me, during daytime people call me a healer because they need my help. And during nighttime they call me a witch because they gossiping about me.
And men too?
Men too. Men too, and there are a lot of stories about competition between a warlock and a witch, and who is stronger, and they give riddles to each other. It's a very strong alive tradition. The same as house spirit, but not forest spirit. Forest spirit stories, they exist in some, mostly in the Russian north and a little bit on the west of Russia, but not in Belarus. And it's amazing how religious are people in motherland village, and they totally deny witchcraft, they deny house spirits, and they deny any kind of spirits. And we believe in God, only God. So you keep asking and keep asking, say, no. If they trust you, maybe they tell one, two stories, but it's nothing to compare with Siberian villages when you can do hours and hours of stories about witches.
But they don't tell you, but they do
believe
in those
they
things?
Do not have them in their practice, in their narrations.
Oh.
Maybe some rumors, maybe, but it's not actual, it's not a live part of tradition in modern Belarus and modern Ukraine. They're very religious, very orthodox. So, but if you take orthodox away, you'll have all those things coming back.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Very cool. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You're very welcome.
Well, you can at least, you can put it on again, your organization. For